Hello. The purpose of this video is to record a concept of a subspace, this time for a general vector space, and to study some particular examples of vector spaces. A subspace S of a vector space X is defined exactly as in linear algebra, meaning that it is a non-empty subset of a vector space X, so that the condition star shown here holds, and here x and y are arbitrary elements of the subset S, and alpha and beta are arbitrary scalars. So by definition, for any x and y, this linear combination belongs to the vector space X, because the space is closed under linear combinations. So the real condition of the subspace is that this linear combination should also, in addition, belong to the set S whenever X and Y are elements of the set S. And in the terminology of the previous video, the condition star here means precisely that the subset S should be closed under linear combinations of its elements. And indeed, as we saw before, if this condition is satisfied, we have that all finite linear combinations of elements of S belong to S as well. As another basic property, a subspace always contains the zero element of the vector space X. And this property is quite easy to see again from the condition star, if we simply choose the scalars alpha and beta both to be equal to zero. And this is why often the best way to begin proving that some set is a subspace is to show that it contains the zero element, and because of this, it is not an empty set. And conversely, proving that the zero element is not in a set sometimes is a convenient way to show that a given set is not a subspace at all. And it's also very straightforward to verify that all the axioms of the vector space are in fact also satisfied for the elements of S, which is a subspace, when the vector addition and scaling are defined in the same way as on the larger vector space X. And this is why every subspace S is a vector space by itself as well. And for us, this opens up a nice and convenient way of showing that some set X is a vector space if we can simply identify X as a subspace of a larger space X tilde, which we have already proved or otherwise know to be a vector space. And probably the easiest example of a subspace of a vector space is a set containing a single element only, the zero element of the vector space X. And this set is indeed a subspace, and this can be proved using the vector space axioms. The proof itself is quite straightforward. I wouldn't say it's trivial, but it's presented in detail in the lecture notes. And this subspace containing only the zero element is known commonly as the trivial subspace, and correspondingly those subspaces which contain at least one other element besides the zero element are called non-trivial. And as more interesting examples, we'll take a look at several different subspaces of the space CI of continuous functions on a real interval. And as mentioned, this analysis shows that these sets we consider here also become vector spaces when they are equipped with the same pointwise addition and scalar multiplication of continuous functions. And similar spaces as we consider here can also be defined for functions of several variables, but for simplicity we'll only be considering functions of a single variable here. As our first example, we have the set of all polynomials with complex coefficients. And it should be noted that there's also no restriction on the order of the polynomial, so the set Pi contains polynomials of all orders. And because all polynomials are continuous functions, Pi is indeed a subset of Ci in the space of continuous functions on the interval. If we want to show the subspace property, we'll first note that the zero function is a polynomial, so Pi is indeed not an empty set. And the actual subspace property, the condition star, can be verified quite easily by noting that the linear combination of two polynomials is again a polynomial. And this means that Pi is indeed a subspace of the space Ci. Other subsets of the space Ci that we can consider here can be defined by assuming that the elements of these spaces have a certain number of continuous derivatives. And for a given natural number n, the elements of Cn are assumed to have at least n continuous derivatives. And on the other hand, the space C infinity is defined as the space of functions for which the derivatives of all orders are continuous. And both of these spaces clearly contain the zero function because it has an infinite number of continuous derivatives. And we also know from elementary calculus that these spaces are closed under taking linear combinations. And so because of this analysis, we can see that both of these sets we've defined here are actually subspaces of the space Ci of continuous functions. And the elements in C infinity are often referred to as smooth functions because they have very nice differentiability properties. And as our final example of a subspace of Ci, we can define the space of functions on the whole real line R, which are smooth and for which there exists a limit m, after which the function only has zero values. And here it's quite important to note that in the definition, this limit m is not fixed, but it can be dependent on the function f. And for any function, it's only required that some m exists. These functions in the space are known as, are referred to as smooth functions with so-called compact support. And we'll get to the more precise definition of and meaning of this term. But this really here refers to the fact that the functions only have non-zero values in some compact subset of the real line R. And the subspace analysis again starts by noting that the zero function is indeed, as we saw before, a smooth function, and it also satisfies this support condition for any limit m. And this means that the set we've defined here is not the empty set. To show the subspace property, we can take two functions f and g from the set CC infinity, and we can take two arbitrary scalars alpha and beta. And since by definition both f and g vanish outside some bounded intervals, we can also deduce that their linear combination gets only zero values outside the larger one of these two intervals. And because the linear combination also has continuous derivatives of all orders, the combination belongs to the set CC infinity by definition. And this again brings us to the conclusion that CC infinity is indeed a subspace of the space of continuous functions on all of R. And as the final thought in this video, we can analyze the definition of a subspace a bit further. And what we can do is we can note that the subspace property of S depends only in a very particular way on the larger vector space X. And in fact, the definition only requires that S has to be a subset of the space X, and then the condition star here depends on how the operations of vector addition and scalar multiplication are defined on the space X. And what this actually implies is that a subspace S is in fact a subspace of any vector space X, which first of all contains the elements of S, and where these two operations are defined in the same way. And this observation and the corollary stated here immediately give us more subspace relationships between the function spaces that we've studied on the past few slides. And for example, since polynomials have continuous derivatives of all orders, the space of polynomials Pi is a subset of the space C infinity of spoof functions and Cn for any n. And because of our observation here, Pi is also a subspace of both of these spaces. And similarly, Cm is a subspace of the space Cn when m is at least n. But of course, we can also remember that only the zero polynomial can vanish outside a bounded interval of R. And because this subset property is really required in the definition of a subspace, we can note that the space PR of polynomials on the real line is not a subspace of the space of smooth functions with compact support.